I was sitting there watching the countdown, waiting for myself to appear, and I was realizing, oh man, I gotta go click on it. Environmental terrorist groups. There's 440 of them we know about worldwide, and they all got nuclear military industrial complexes, power plants, and they make fuel for directed energy weapons there, isotopes. I'll come over and say hi to everybody in a few seconds here. I just wanted to make sure everybody understood the very basis of what I'm saying here is that Fukushima's in Japan. It's got 3 melted reactors, and it's St. Paddy's Day every day into the ocean, every minute of every day, and also into the environment. We have WIPP, where we have... Hang on. And so WIPP, let me see, you know, here's what I learned about WIPP from all the PR spokespersons and WIPP staff and everybody else in New Mexico, Carlsbad. You would get more radiation. Hang on. You would get... let me come over that. Let me click that. Let me click this. You get more radiation if you're closer to man-made radiation, contaminated areas, and you get less radiation if you're further away from contaminated areas. 7 years of college, dear. You get more radiation if you're on a plane with a smoke detector, with radon 241 into it or something, or americium 241. At 50,000 feet, getting a CAT scan and a dental x-ray while you're drinking a glass of water with 7,500 becquerels of potassium-40 and now 7,400 becquerels of man-made cesium-137 as a drinking water standard. Now that's actually cubic meter of water, whereas 7,500 becquerels of potassium-40 is in your drinking water, which is irrelevant. Cesium's not. In a bathtub full of ocean water and rocks that are releasing natural uranium-238 and natural radon with the plane's curtains up, sun shining in on you, because sunshine is worse radiation than any nuclear fallout ever in the entire history of mankind. Eating a banana, and you get more radiation eating a banana, according to mainstream media, than you would from WIPP or from plutonium or from uranium-238, then you will if you're standing in the middle of any spot where man-made radioactive fallout had occurred. Oh, and you will get less radiation if you're on a space station than if you stood in the middle of Fukushima Daiichi military industrial complexes, nuclear, disguised as a nuclear power plant where they make fuel for directed energy weapons. So isotopes is the fuel for directed energy weapons. I know that's a big mouthful. And you cannot make uranium-238 yellow cake from bananas. And if you do get radiation fallout, it's probably from nuclear testing in the 50s and the 60s. Don't worry, all you gotta do is lick an iPhone charger or smile, and radiation can't hurt you. You gotta keep that smile though. I mean, you let the smile down, radiation get you good. But if you smile, the radiation cannot hurt you, because it's like pouring a spoonful of water into the ocean and trying to measure the sea level change. Did I get that right? Well, that's a big mouthful, isn't it? But I mean, that's the official story according to all the media and all the PR firms out there who best go hide out in FEMA camps in the near future when people find out what the real story is. Let me come back up here. And we got Hanford, where they put 450 billion gallons directly into the soil, just poured it into the soil. Not in drums, but poured it into the soil. Not counting all the drums and everything else. Hanford is 500 miles. It's got 41 miles of open pits where they dump uranium-238 that's contaminated with all the heavy metals, with all the americiums, the neptuniums, the plutoniums. Open pits that are not even lined, not that you can line it, you wouldn't want to line it. You might start a chain reaction if all these metals are mixing together at the bottom of it. And that actually happened at the Tetka River in Russia in the late 40s, or actually that was the 50s, where they had storage tanks detonated and they ended up losing another 1,000 square miles But before that happened, they had lost 9,000 square miles in 7,500 communities. They had closed them down and evacuated them because of the Techa River. And a decade later, they had tanks explode there because it had all the heavy metals into the bottom of it. Just like Fukushima got all those big tanks there. All the heavy metal goes down on the bottom, causes a chain reaction, actually melt down through the tank, just like a nuclear, like coriums disappearing into the earth are doing in Fukushima. Let me keep going. Sellafield, England. There are terrorists. There are some serious environmental terrorists. They got 8 million liters of radioactive contaminated material, water, and isotopes, and atoms, and particles leaching into the UK ocean every friggin' day, folks. Like little Fukushima. Or Fukushima's like Sellafield on steroids. Fukushima's got 3 melted cores. You had Chernobyl. You lost 3,500 square kilometers there. But I mean, it's a lot more contaminated than that. But they got that much you can't go back to. But people are going there. But you hear a lot of people that are saying, oh, the animals all came back. Don't believe that one. Go ahead and look up the studies on what happened to the animals. I haven't got time for it right now. You have Three Mile Island. And by the way, Chernobyl was a 30% meltdown. And it's one-third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima. Then you have Three Mile Island. That was a 50% meltdown. And they had a huge release. They're still denying it. All the apologists are out there still today denying it. But they had a huge, massive release. That's confirmed. You had the SL-1. This is where they in the 50s, they took a reactor and they didn't, and the containment unit. Oh, well, it's not in a populated area, so we don't have to worry about it. So they wanted it to have an accident. And so they can study it, I guess. But they put it, hang on. Oh, I don't want to get that one wrong. SL-1, where you to? Peaky boo. Oh. Come on. Oh, yeah. That was a bad one. They didn't build a containment unit very thick because, hang on. Because it was 60 kilometers, I think it is, outside of a big city in the United States, Idaho. That went over to Yellowstone National Park, all that radioactive fallout. So radioactive fallout, and then, don't get me started. 40 miles, 64 kilometers of Idaho Falls, Idaho, the SL-1, the stationary low power reactor number one. And this was designed to break down so they can study a nuclear radiation fallout and everything else. That's actually what happened there. They've been trying to bury it ever since and change the numbers and change it from Rads to Currys and change it over to Beckwells and just totally try to confuse you and misinformation for you. Did I miss anybody? Hanford. And Hanford, that's pouring into Columbia River, and then you got downwinders of people. Anybody that lives around a nuclear power plant anywhere on the planet is being terrorized by environmental terrorists. Right, because you hear all the nuclear pro speakers out there. We got to get nuclear power. Nuclear power only accounts for 3% of the energy on the planet. Look at the carnage. 9,000 miles evacuated, 7,500 communities. Add on to Chernobyl, 3,500 communities. Add on another 1,000 square miles evacuated because of detonation of storage tanks. Add on another 1,000 miles evacuated in Russia because of a pond where they were storing it in went dry during the drought, and they lost another 1,000 square miles. And I mean, they only provide 3% of the energy on the planet. Then look at Fukushima, where it's hemorrhaging into the ocean, extraordinary radioactive materials, nonstop, like St. Paddy's Day, all night. If that radiation was like dye, you'd get it in a hurry. But you're gonna have to use common sense so you can understand it, that it really does look like dye every day, non-stop, continuously going into the oceans. The same thing with Sellafield, UK, England. Look at all the barrels, the t- tens of thousands every year they were dumping into the ocean of the waste, which has a half-life of 4.5 billion years. And those radioactive isotopes, you know, some radioactive isotopes are solutable in water. Does that mean they're not still radioactive? Of course not. The water is now radioactive. Right, you see how they can spin it for you? And now that the EPA has set the standards at 7,500 becquerels per cubic meter of cesium-137, which is a man-made radioactive isotope for North America, so your drinking water got 7,500 becquerels added onto it now for the rest of your lifetime and your children's lifetime, if you're lucky to have that lifetime. Because you got to think about how much strontium they're not counting. My numbers are 225,000 becquerels in a cubic meter of water, because you can't have that cesium without that, and you can't have any of it without the uranium, 234, 235, and definitely 238. 97% of the fuel in the reactors is 238. And you can't have any of it without the plutonium and all their daughters and all their morphs. So alluding that there's 7,500 becquerels, new becquerels now, that they're going to call safe, and there is no such thing as a safe. It's a cumulative. So we need to do something about this. We need to build filters. If not for ourselves, for future generations. The technology is not going to save it. This is not what's supposed to happen to humanity. We got GMO has engineered all the nutrition out of our food. This is not humanity. This is not life on Earth anymore. This is how do we strangle every creature on this planet. How do we destroy all living entities, everything on this planet? We fire 2.5 million rounds a month of dirty bombs into Iraq for 9 years. McAllister's bomb manufacturer is one of four bomb manufacturing facilities in the United States dedicated to making dirty bombs, uranium-238. San Francisco had 45,000 barrels dumped on its coastline. And that's 30 miles outside of San Francisco. And oh, you know, all the animals, all the seals getting sick. Oh no, it's chicken pox. All the stuff going into the ocean consistently. And oh, by the way, you know, there's a big fight on about the starfish. Everything, oh, you know, it never happened because the starfish happened in 2008. They've been dumping shit in the ocean long before that. And just because 2008 is the first time they recorded it, how come they didn't record it 10 years before that, and 10 years before that, and 20 years before that? I dove for 14 years. I've never seen anything like it. 300 days a year, 315 rather days a year average in the ocean, on the ocean floor, 6 hours a day. On both oceans. And you can't tell me just because it happened in 2008 that has nothing to do with radiation, because starfish are very vulnerable. But I don't base any of my assumptions, and I don't have assumptions, I don't have conjectures, I have all facts, just like I just told you. But I mean, that one is used all the time to try to bludgeon people. Who cares about the starfish in this context when we have so thousands of documented proof? But now we have the EPA at 7,500 becquerels of cesium-137 is a standard in your drinking water. That's not what you hired these people for. That's not what you created these people for. That's not their job to raise the limit. Their job is to deal with that, to come up with solutions. Their job is to raise the alarm. Their job is to rally the nation to solve that issue. Their job is not to bury it and not tell you about it, not have a debate about it, not even try to come up with a solution for it, not even acknowledge it outside of the point of having all the apologists from Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution and all the pro and all the universities, which are all pro-nuclear. Otherwise, you don't get no money. And so all the deans of all the universities are cowards, are maggots of our society. Right? They all give out funding to go look at nicotine and try to leak it to cancer when there's 4,000 chemicals in your cigarette. They don't even try to build sarcophaguses at university. They just try to find ways to look at the minutest radioactive particles that are indigenous and normal and put that into equation so you can't look at the whole picture of what nuclear industry is all about and how this works and why it's so naughty or why it's so wicked, why it's so alien, why it's so hideous, why it's so monstrous. Why is it on this planet? It's not supposed to be on this planet. It's a creature that doesn't exist on the moon, that doesn't exist on Mars. These man-made radioactive isotopes, and they should never, they're not supposed to. Licensing agreement is every isotope is locked away, but all the terrorist groups, nuclear power plants, the military industrial complexes, they're all military industrial complexes. You don't need all these isotopes, 3,100 isotopes, to make power. You need 3,100 isotopes to feed the directed energy weapons, and you killed everything doing it. And now you're going to raise limits, and then introduce limits that are man-made. And then everybody, no, it never made it here. Well, how do you end up with cesium-137 as a standard in your drinking water when there is zero safe limits of cesium-137 in anything? There is no safe levels. And we got to do the right thing. It's hard to get here every night and do this. But you got all these people coming on board all the time, and they're worried, they're scared, they're terrified, they're misinformed, they're badgered, they're mocked for even considering it, for even looking at it, for even worrying about it, for even raising the issue. What? Fukushima? What? Radiation? What? That's what they get. Because of the gross, disgusting universities, the PR firms, the lobbyists, and the lapdogs in the media themselves, which that's their job. They're PR firms all by themselves. You go to anybody out there that writes for the major organizations, the major papers, the major media, or is in their radio, or is in their TV, and look at their history. They got a list of credentials of PR talents. And their job, no matter how sick and disgusting it is to get on TV, read the teleprompter, and smile and try to sell it to you. Body language, hair, clothing, everything is used to indoctrinate you. And then when someone tries to tell you there's actually something here, you're left with, well, you know, they said it's like a banana. And so, I mean, why would a professor lie to me, Dana? Why would a professor get on TV and lie? They would call him out. No, they won't. They can't. Nobody will ever advertise with him again. That's what they do. Right? The advertiser reads the script. You know, do you get how this all works? How it's always worked? How it'll always work? Unless you take that step. You got to take a step. I mean, we need millions of voices. You know, if I had a float plane, I had a helicopter, and I had a 300-foot ship, and a whole bunch of other stuff, I'd go out and find the 1,000 square miles of radioactive debris coming over and put cameras out there and stream it. I'd stream, live stream, go out there with the gear and find it and live stream it as you're doing it. Everything. Crowdfund it that way, probably. But everybody could see the Geiger counters in real time. And you had people who knew what they were doing. That would be a good, you know, sign of good faith. Putting nutrition back into our food instead of taking all the potassium. This is what they done. They took potassium, all the nutrients, the magnesium, the iron, the calcium, out of your genetically modified food. And so it's not food anymore because it doesn't have them. And they engineered 5 toxins, one of them a dioxin, into your food. And so that's not food. It looks like food. It's very pretty. It's fascinating how good it looks. But it has zero nutrition in it. This is on purpose. They're not trying to deal with the radiation and updated your countries, your continents, for 3 years. Hardcore from the St. Paddy's Day, the never-ending Groundhog St. Paddy's Day. That's what we got here, is a Groundhog's St. Paddy's Day every minute, 1,440 minutes a day. It'll go on till the end of time, until we run out of homeless, got to run away. Then you might get it. Because they're not going to go in there. As long as they can get homeless, they'll stay there. They run out of homeless, and that's coming in Fukushima. They need homeless now for WIPP, and homeless for Hanford, homeless for Chernobyl to go in there and do the work. They put 6,000 soldiers in Chernobyl. They all got medals, and they got thrown away like garbage. But there were 600,000 of them. It's one-third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima and three melted reactors. It's so important. It's so vital. And now we have confirmation of 7,500 becquerels of cesium being introduced through all the venues out there, introducing everybody to it and propagating everybody with all the medias, particularly Woods Hole. They're actually quite evil. That's all they do. Their job is to cover up and stop the blowback and control the blowback from whatever they're doing out there, right? Ah, Woods Hole will go in and investigate it. Popular Mechanics is another one. National Geographic's is another one. Their job is to come out with documentaries and come out with big flashy ships with, right, and then sell it that way. And they're all PR spokespersons. They're all extraordinarily trained. And they're going to tell you that a radioactive isotope is equal to a banana. They're going to tell you that a radioactive isotope, and that's a lie, because if you eat a banana, you off-gas. If you eat a radioactive isotope, you sequester it into your organs, into your bones, into your muscles, into your blood. But they're going to tell you that the radiation from Fukushima is like a banana. Or they're going to tell you the radiation from WIPP is like a dental x-ray. Or they're going to tell you the radiation from Hanford is equal to a walk in the sunshine. Or they're going to tell you that the radiation from Three Mile Island is equal to your drinking water. Which is a outright fabrication. Drink 7,500 becquerels in your drinking water of potassium, that's normal. And you off-gas 7,500 becquerels. Now every time you do it, you got 7,500 becquerels and 7,400 becquerels of cesium-137 lurking around in your shower and your water and your vegetables and the effects of that. Well, you're not going to drink a cubic meter of water, but what about the 225,000 becquerels of strontium that's going to be in that, has to come along with that too, per cubic meter? What about the uranium, all the becquerels till the end of time? What about all the 1,000 stable, long-life, man-made radioactive isotopes? What about the 3,100 isotopes? 260 of them are natural. The rest of them are hideous creatures that are not supposed to be on this planet. There's no purpose on the planet. The only purpose on the planet is to destroy the planet. Like, the implications of everything I'm saying to you, it's not a joke. It's not a game. This is not a fable. This is not a fiction. This is not something I want to do. This is something I definitely do not want to be doing. I just don't want, you know, anything but this. I'd give it all up in a heartbeat if there was a way out for me, but there's not. You know, we got to carry this message out there. That we have an issue and we have an opportunity. We have the technology to at least try. We have 4,800 peer-reviewed academic studies that are published, not published, but published every day. And these institutions, these professors, these students, these man hours, these locations are all ready to go again. And they can come up with filters. 4,800 universities in the world went to work doing a contest come up with the best filter, and they all share their information. And then the day after, 4,800 universities and students and academics and institutions start putting nutrition into food. I'd feel a lot better. But right now we have these environmental terrorist groups that are not going to give it up. This is too easy money for them. And they don't care because it's going to happen to their own children. They go out and they get all this money and they buy swimming pools, and their swimming pools, every cubic meter is going to be 7,500 becquerels of this, hot man-made radioactive isotopes, 225,000 becquerels of strontium man-made radioactive isotopes, hundreds of thousands of the other radioactive man-made isotopes their children will be swimming in every day. They can't escape that in their showers or in their bathtubs. It's in their best interest to come on board. It's in everybody's best interest, except for a handful of the elites who somehow think they're going to come out on top of this. But they lose everything. We lose everything, the entire biosphere, the entire oceans. We can't stop the hemorrhaging because we don't try. We send in the homeless to do the most dangerous job on the planet who can't even read or can't even write. And somehow or another, I'm the bad guy for talking about this. For criticizing Woods Hole and everything else out there, for using bananas and walking in sunshine and insignificant potassium 40 into these equations. And all that does is confuse people, and it's hard for people to digest it, what's going on. It's hard to pick through the lies when that's what they do. That's all they do, is they keep injecting potassium 40 and high insignificant normal everyday background radiation, high counts of that, and then comparing it to low counts of the man-made radioactive material when none of it is true. It's meant to confuse you. And what all I'm trying to do to you is make you understand that a banana, if you eat that kind of radiation, it doesn't belong in a conversation, but I have to come up here every single night and drive it home. I have to do that constantly because after 5 decades, they ain't going to give it up. And so the only thing that could stop this is 4,800 universities coming on board and doing the right thing, or everybody starting to rise and speak out and lash out and stand up and correct the misnomers. Because if you go approach any of the experts, they're going to try to hit you with a banana. That's not going to work on you. You say, well, I can eat a banana, I'm going to off-gas it. If I eat the cesium, then I'm going to keep that in me forever. And it's cumulative. Every time I eat something, I got more into me. It doesn't go away. If I inhale it, it's many times worse. But because these radioactive particles are so small, so tiny, so durable, such a long, and to see like a half-life in radioactive terminology is actually times 10. See how they lie to you and how they manipulate you? Oh, it's only got an 8-day half-life. It's 80 days. But it didn't come by itself. Radioactive isotopes don't just travel. All the gases don't just split up, and all the radioactive atoms and particles don't just go their own way. Right? No, of course not. The Trans-Pacific pollution studies I've shown and talked about recently, how smoke and forest fires can easily get up into the jet stream, but will also easily cross the oceans and will congregate and accumulate on the continent and turn into smog right from across the ocean in a matter of a week. Pollution from automobiles and smog got moved into the city, across the ocean, contributed to your pollution, or our pollution, or their pollution. And we know California had over 1,500 radioactive atoms, hot particles, with the isotope in them, per cubic meter of air, lingering in California. Shocking. It's so shocking. And it was the same thing all the way along the coastline. Hot particles lingered. For studies below of Health Canada going out and flying through plumes for 18 hours, lingering from one end of British Columbia to the other end. Really high particles. They were only looking for a couple of certain isotopes. For 18 hours, they flew through the plumes. March 20th, 2000. And 11. And so you'll keep hearing people say you can't make it across the ocean, but there's the jet streams. They're here in 3 days, 4 days, By the end of a week, it's everywhere. In North America. Nothing left. Nothing can escape it. But under the jet stream is the most biggest loads. And if you don't know any better and you're eating GMO, you're in a lot of trouble. Because that fuels cancer. All on its own. And so what's the glyphosates and the formaldehyde going to do to you? The toxins and the dioxins that they got engineered into it going to do to you when you got no nutrition to battle it? Even if it was full of nutrition, just with the glyphosates and the formaldehydes and the three other toxic pesticides they have built into the DNA of the food, which is not food, it's a creature, it's a GMO creature. It doesn't qualify as food. There's tiny particles of everything left, but they're insignificant. You can't engineer it all out or the plant won't exist, and it can't pass a certain standard, I guess. But it's inconceivable if you look at the studies of what they've done to GMO foods and how 100% of your corner shops, 80% of your grocery shops, and the rest of it is contaminated with pesticides anyway. You can't trust a single word that comes out of your mouth. They've been caught so many times. With natural and organic turns out to be GMO and GMO. And we have this capacity. We have this amazing ability as a human race that we could dig ourselves out of this one. And, but it's, I mean, it's just, if you put cancer-fighting agents, the actual ones, not the pharmaceutical ones, because all your pet food and all your baby food, all your supplements, GMO, all your pharmaceuticals, GMO, then the bovines, the growth hormones, and the vaccines they use in your cows or in your meats and stuff like that. You're better off eating turkeys, because turkeys are free range, and you get a lot more meat for your money, and it's much, much healthier meat than chicken. I can't eat chicken. I won't touch it. Turkey's good. They free range it. They're not chopping the beaks off. They're not, you know, the animals are running around, and they're harvested a couple of points a year. So compared to a chicken, it's a much more ethical meat. It doesn't have the adrenaline in it from stress and everything else. Everybody's like, fuck off, Dana, leave me alone. I like chicken. But I realize I gotta have one of those chats where these are environmental terrorist groups. Yeah? I should come down and say hi to everybody. These are environmental terrorist groups. Fukushima, WIPP, Hanford, 3 Mile Island. By no means are this all of them. There's 440 that we know about. There's SL1, Chernobyl, Techa River in Russia. There's, which lost 9,000 square miles and 7,500 communities. Sellafield, England, 8 million liters a day. That's where they used to make the MOX fuel. There's Pakistan, freaky fuckers. Excuse the language. India, there's crazy Israel down there, shooting 25,000 depleted uranium, 155 millimeter from the, right? You know, like think about the A-10 Warthog. Let me go back to Israel for a second. 25,000, 155 millimeter depleted uranium rounds into Palestine, into the communities, into the neighborhoods, indiscriminate, with a 900-foot kill ratio. That's friggin' crazy stuff. Because all that blows right back into their own country. It's just like they just don't care. You got Russia doing it. China's doing it. There's a whole bunch of countries out there. I mean, what England done is just over the top friggin' evil. Dumping it. Barrels after barrels nonstop off UK. And then now they got Sellafield hemorrhaging 8 million liters a day. This is over the top. This is unacceptable. And people don't know. And people don't understand because they're inundated with bananas, walking in sunshine, 7,500 becquerels of potassium, 40 in your water, blah, 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 from all the apologists, from all the creepy, creepy, disgusting people that we actually thought, you know, was there to flush out and were experts. There are experts in deception and misrepresentation. A misdirection. And that's why I exist, because I just can't take that anymore, and I know better. And so what I know, I know. And so what I know, I discuss. It's like a gram of uranium is enough to power 333,000-watt heaters. Imagine being in a room, really good insulation, no windows, no doors, and 333 heaters. And that gram of uranium is going to run them on a nuclear, the way they do it with nuclear, the fuel lasts 12 months, 24 months, and then they pull it out. But that uranium still has energy, it's just no good for that nuclear E equals MC squared formula. They need a certain enrichment, blah, 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 for their isotopes, so it's no good. I mean, you can still use that to make the old-fashioned power plants work, what's left over. You can just keep reusing this stuff. But a gram of it is 1,000,000 watts. And that's like turning 3,000-watt heater on in a little room, but 333 of them. That's energy. It doesn't matter if you aerosol it and atomize it like happened at Fukushima at all. You still have that energy. It's still free radicals. It's still pumping it out. If you get it in your body in 1,000,000 years' time, it'll give you the same kind of cancer as it would on the first day. It doesn't lose its energy. And so when you're releasing these 1,000,000 watts at a time, that's, you're increasing 1,000,000 watts with this own creature. That's how I see it explained in layman's term into the environment. When you're talking about hundreds of thousands of tons, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of tons of this stuff aerosoled and atomized and released into the environment, that's global warming. That's global warming on an unimaginable scale. These are hot particles. These are pumping out energy at the, you know, the gammas, the betas, and the alphas are traveling at almost the speed of light. Not quite, but close to it. How do you get those speeds and not have a side effect in your environment? There's a good article, study, Small Nuclear War. Seen something Drudge today. I happen to be on it for a minute. I was like, oh, radiation, let me go check it out. Small nuclear war would destroy the world. I'm just gonna get a little bit loud. With an estimated 17,000 weapons in the world, we have the power to exterminate the humanity many times over. But it would take a full-scale, it wouldn't take a full-scale nuclear war to make Earth uninhabitable. We were shooting 2.5 million rounds of dirty bombs in Iraq every friggin' month. 5 million rounds a month. Imagine you shot 5 million rounds in New York City. Every month, month after month. You get any civilians? Would there be any windows left? Especially if you had the crazy retarded Americans. No offense to anybody who's retarded or got someone who is. And that's a name that I don't want to, you know, lose because it's a powerful slur. And it's not meant to offend anybody, only the people I'm directing it to. As an insult, I'm sure I could come up with a better one. Even a small regional nuclear war on the other side of the planet would disrupt global climate for at least a decade and wipe out the ozone layer for a decade. What's going to happen when you're releasing all these radioactive atomized... See, a nuclear war radioactive material is totally different than what we talk about at Fukushima and Sellafield and Hanford. But like Fukushima in particular, where it's running over the hot coriums, the water, and getting up into the ocean, being liberated into the environment, but it's also aerosoled on the coriums and released into the environment. That's steam. And by the way, every nuclear power plant has got fuel pools. They're going through 100,000 liters a day of radioactive water, and it's evaporated into your environment. And that's why leukemia is so high around nuclear power plants and in communities with nuclear power plants downwind or downriver, rather. And downwind, you know, where the prevailing winds are if you live in that regional district area. They said today that autism just jumped by 30%. They never changed the way they look for it. They never changed the way they test for it. They never changed the way they seek out. They said it rose by 30%. In Japan, in Fukushima Prefecture, 6 out of 10 children tested were diabetic, which is another direct issue that's connected apparently directly to radiation. Sister Jackie Hudson. And years ago, she spent a lot of time, she was a nun, she had spent a lot of time at the hospital. I can't remember which one it was. And she was a nun, and so there was a children's hospital, and she got to know the pediatrician, obviously, because she lost so many children to cancer, treating them for cancer. And that pediatrician had done a lot of soul searching, and a lot of searching, and had discovered that all the children that come in there and that she treats, she couldn't save them no matter how good she was. Even though she taught in university, that's what she was going to accomplish. And she got her dream job, and she couldn't save the children. And one day she had come to the realization that the reason for these types of cancers that children were dying of was directly related, all of them, to the nuclear industry, to living in the community downriver or close to the reactors. All the children had that in common. And this was a revolutionary thing for Sister Jackie Hudson. And she dedicated the rest of her life to going against the nuclear industry. And she was also arrested. She was put in jail, and she was made to clean the Humvees that came back from Iraq, and they were contaminated with uranium-238. And so there was a bunch of them, and they used to get really sick, break out in sores. You hear Dr. Doug Rourke, the head of the Pentagon in Kuwait in 91 on the Highway of Death, where, think about the A-10 Warthog, it shoots a ton and a half of uranium-238 that's contaminated with the plutonium and all the other radioactive isotopes because it's left over from the chain reaction. It's supposed to be in a sarcophagus, not in a plane as a bullet. That's not what the licensing agreements are. All the nuclear power plants producing 3% of the electricity on the entire friggin' planet. Nothing. And look at the carnage they have done. Look at the absolute carnage they've created on this planet. That's not going to go away. You're not going to get those 9,000 square miles in Russia back, or the 3,500 square kilometers, or the 30,000 square miles, kilometers in Japan. You're not going to be able to decontaminate that. You can't decontaminate. If my hand was radioactive and I poured battery acid over it, I would liberate the radioactive isotopes and particles and atoms and blah, 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 and have no hand. But you can't kill it. You can put my hand in an incinerator and burn it at 5,000 degrees. You're just going to liberate the isotopes, the atoms, the particles. Do you get any idea how hideous this shit is and why we need 4,800 peer review? Look, if you looked up and you seen a comet coming at you, you'd have 4,800 peer review academic studies tomorrow morning with the funding and good to go. All the parents packing the kids' lunch. Come on, Johnny. Come on, Sally. Don't forget. Don't be late. You got to get to university and save the world, honey. But we can turn the other cheek and pretend it's not going to happen, that there is no meteorite coming at us named Fukushima, that we didn't increase the water standards now to include man-made radioactive isotopes of just cesium-137, which is hideous, unimaginably hideous, but we're not including 30 times more strontium-90 like we should be, which goes directly into your bones. We're not including the uranium and the plutoniums and all their daughters, 238, the 239, the 240, 241, but the many other aberrations that go with these decays and these radioactive changes of these particles and atoms. And so researchers developed a computer model of the Earth's atmosphere and ran simulations to find out what would happen if there was a nuclear war with just a fraction of the world's arsenal. What they saw was the stuff of nightmares. Of nightmares. This was a study. And we have more than that amount of radiation released into our environment from 9 years of firing dirty bombs in Iraq every month, 2.5 million, and Fukushima and Sellafield and Hanford and, you know, just in that time allotment. And so should I be here each night doing what I'm doing? Even though it wears me the freak right to just frazzles me. But it drives me because I know I can't escape this, and neither can you. and that people out there are looking for the truth, and that if we don't have something for these people so they can learn, so they can have some closure, so they can try to readjust, so they can get out of the friggin' way, so they can actually make an informed decision, then we're in a lot of trouble. Because I couldn't get that. And it took me 4 months to put that together. And I'm trying to put together a documentary so anybody can get it the first time out and get everything. Because I think everybody is more than capable of understanding the implications, the facts, and some of the solutions, and maybe coming up with incredible solutions if they can understand what the problem is, what the issue is, what the parameters are. And that they can't trust a university, and that they can't trust it without doing a test on it first. We need like a little testing tube where we put a professor in and we shake him with some solution, and if he turns it like yellow, he knows he's one of those banana monsters who's out there lying. Because that's a lie. That's a blatant lie. Saying that you would get more radiation by eating a banana than you would from Fukushima, like Ken Buesler. You get more radiation by eating a banana than you would from WIPP, like Dr. John Neal from Oklahoma. From these, you know, these people that are representing these huge institutions, for them to come out and say that. The university has every right in the book to fire them. There's no excuse not to fire them. It's unacceptable for anybody to coming out of a university to get on TV, and for TV not to even fact check it on top of that. It's like a hockey game where everybody on the team had to fail before it was the goalies, right? And he didn't really fail, he'd done the best he could. Well, we're the goalie, and we're doing the best we can. And we're up against constant attacks, constant assaults, constant slander. I give my own too, I can be quite the asshole, don't get me wrong. But because it, the importance of it, I don't have time for nonsense. I don't have time for games. I try to, but I have a short fuse with anything out there that's going to waste my time, my energy, my efforts, my words. And these are valuable to me. These are important to me. These are all I got. And nobody can take that away from me unless I do that to myself. And, you know, I'm a human just like you. I'm pretty sure that I don't want to be doing this. And that's why I have the attitude I get. It's because I don't want to be doing this. I don't want to be saying these things. I don't want to live this life. I don't want to have to talk about this. I don't want this to be happening. I'm just like you. But I understand the importance, the significance, and the implications. And, you know, I have no options. There's nothing I can do about what I'm doing. If I don't do it, who's going to do it? You know, I trust myself, see? I trust that anybody that watches any of my videos, that I did not lie to them, that I did not misrepresent anything to them, that I did not take anything out of context, that everything I say, I truly believe the words I say, and that I have done more soul searching than many people put together before I got to this stage. And so I understand the emotions, I understand the lies, I understand the implications. And so I don't understand why the scientists who must understand it much better than me can do the things they're doing, manipulate the way they're doing, deceive the way they're doing, unless they're psychopathic, or unless they believe it and they were, you know, some of these people probably do believe the stuff they're saying and don't understand. Because they've been lied to so much themselves, and they've been indoctrinated. They got the easy street. They grew up in the inbreed, you know. Think about the deans of the universities and how they have all failed us, and how they continue to fail us, and how we pay their pensions, how we pay their universities, we pay their power, we pay for their expendables, we pay for their entire life, we pay for their luxuries. Is there loved ones that are there with thousands of free man hours? 1.6 million billion man hours a year. 1.6 million peer-reviewed academic studies, 1,000 hours average, and 1,000 page average, say. That's 1.6 billion man hours of your children, and then that gets locked away in Harvard or Elsevier, Springer, and Wiley, the three biggest publishing houses, if they're good peer review studies. And if they're, you know, just insignificant crap, they'll get locked away in some other publishing houses so they can have a little bone. But remember, Elsevier, Springer, and Wiley Publishing owns 20,000 of the most prestigious publishing outfits on the planet, and they get the copyrights from your universities, your institutions, your public entities for free. You paid for it. You paid for everything. Every country is paying billions and billions and billions into their institutions for all these studies. And other universities has to cash out to do the studies, to peer review the study, to certify the study. You have to do the same experiments, the same man hours. And then that's locked away. You can't read it. But you paid for it. And so you're sucked into this little hole where you think, you know, we're getting all this fancy equipment at our universities. We're, you know, society's doing good. No, it's not. This is all locked away. You don't get access to it. You can't utilize it. And the children that done the academic study are not even allowed to talk about it. They're not allowed to give it away because it's the copyrights are given away for free to a handful, not even that, to the publishing houses who are making extraordinary profits off it. And now has turned it into a capital shareholder, which is the most frightening thing imaginable. That destroys your country. This corporate personhood, corporations with human rights, is an illegal amendment to the slavery law. It's a cancer growth on the slavery law. The slavery law was to free the oppressed black people from a tyrannical government, and is being used by corporations to oppress the sovereign people. You're supposed to be a sovereign people. And because of all the lies and all the manipulations and all the promises and all the people you put your faith into to tell you the truth, and they lie to you, they can't come out and say it. They can't come out and just say it. They won't have a job tomorrow morning. And someone might actually kill them. They bought into the mob. That's what this industry is. It's you can't insure it publicly. You have to insure it privately. And then your communities, your taxes, has to bail it out for 1,000 years after for the cleanup and everything else. I got some late night flyboys. I'm going to come down and say hi to everybody. Good night to everybody. Once again, I just went off for 51 minutes, and I meant to be here and say hi to a few people. I only meant to be here for half an hour at night because I'm busy there, and I wanted to just put out a short, articulate one tonight. I kind of went down a long road, and it's not too late if we can push this out there. If I had 5 million people or 30 million people, and a million of them was ready to make videos and come out and slam these people, they couldn't open their mouths again. You took their thunder away. You can do that in a week. I could destroy everything about these people in a week. And we could force the entire friggin' planet to get universities to start making filters for water to get rid of that cesium and everything else. We could actually do that if we try. Well, we don't try. They don't intend to try. This is the plan all along. All nuclear power plants are put in a position where if they fail, they destroy that river, that lake, that ocean. They hemorrhage in there for thousands of years. No one can touch it. There is no technology because they don't try to build it because they don't want to stop it. Your job is to push back. That's why you're here. You wouldn't be here. That's your calling. You're no different than me. Your job is somehow to come up, somebody out there, one of you folks out there, who probably never made a peep in their life, probably never even got a ticket in their life, who probably never even swore in their life, who knows, or swore every day of their life. But there's somebody out there will make this go viral. And I know you're out there, and you don't know who you are. You probably think you have no skill. You probably think you're incapable. You probably think nobody would listen to you. Yeah, you're probably wrong. In fact, I know you are. And it'll only be when that random person can breach with just a simple concept to encompass the things that I try to make less complicated, but are made complicated by the people you're supposed to trust. And that's why I exist, to try to bring some rationale to what they told you and make you understand that you can't trust them because they mentioned bananas and they know better. They have an education. So I'll come and say hi to everybody. Fred Davis. Well, the media doesn't matter so much as everybody talking to each other. But, you know, I hear you. Camshaft. Thanks, Camshaft. Chris Barton. Craig Hindall. Amthurst. Thank you, MSVS. Toxic. Missing Sky. Really busy folks. Stacy Lane, 74. Real busy folks. Reram. You find all kinds of links below. That's okay, Grandma. Ask some kid. Ask one of your nieces or nephews. Mama Knox, thank you, honey. You're a hard worker. We love what you do. Thank you for doing what you do. Mr. Hemi. Youngie. Diver Dudes. That's for Art. Mickey. Thank you, Mickey. Okay, I'll go check Mickey. I'm probably going to crash after this video, though. Guy Spider, Stacy again, Aqua, Black Two, Black Two, I can't pronounce it. I think that's the right one, I suppose. Yeah. Aqua, Paul, Westerfield, thank you. Solar Max. Yeah, they probably got a way to deal with this, folks, and we just need to force it out, right? We have to do that. That is our job. Hi, Mervin. And meanwhile, you gotta lick your iPhone. You gotta do it. It's cool. It's trendy. Everybody gotta do it one time. You gotta lick your iPhone charger. It's trendy. You gotta do it. It's cool. Lick that iPhone. Lick it good. Lick that iPhone charger. Everybody. Add on another 1,000 square miles evacuated because of detonation of storage tanks. Add on another 1,000 miles evacuated in Russia because of a pond where they were storing it in went dry during the drought, and they lost another 1,000 square miles. And I mean, they only provide 3% of the energy on the planet. Then look at Fukushima, where it's hemorrhaging into the ocean, extraordinary radioactive materials nonstop, like St. Paddy's Day, all day, all night. If that radiation was like dye, you'd get it in a hurry. But you're going to have to use common sense so you can understand it, that it really does look like dye every day, nonstop, continuously going into the oceans. The same thing with Sellafield, UK, England. Look at all the barrels, the tens of thousands every year they were dumping into the ocean of the waste, which has a half-life of 4.5 billion years. And those radioactive isotopes, you know, some radioactive isotopes are solutable in water. Does that mean they're not still radioactive? Of course not. The water is now radioactive. Right, you see how they can spin it for you? And now that the EPA has set the standards at 7,500 becquerels per cubic meter of cesium-137, which is a man-made radioactive isotope for North America, so your drinking water got 7,500 becquerels added onto it now for the rest of your lifetime and your children's lifetime, if you're lucky to have that lifetime. Because you got to think about how much strontium they're not counting. My numbers are 225,000 becquerels in a cubic meter of water, because you can't have that cesium without that, and you can't have any of it without the uranium, 234, 235, and definitely 238. 97% of the fuel in the reactors is 238. And you can't have any of it without the plutonium and all their daughters and all their morphs. So alluding that there's 7,500 becquerels new barrels now that they're going to call safe, and there is no such thing as a safe. It's a cumulative. So we need to do something about this. We need to build filters. If not for ourselves, for future generations. The technology is not going to save it. This is not what's supposed to happen to humanity. We got GMO has engineered all the nutrition out of our food. This is not humanity. This is not life on Earth anymore. This is how do we strangle every creature on this planet? How do we destroy all living entities, everything on this planet? We fire 2.5 million rounds a month of dirty bombs into Iraq for 9 years. McAllister's bomb manufacturer is one of four bomb manufacturing facilities in the United States dedicated to making dirty bombs, uranium-238. San Francisco had 45,000 barrels dumped on its coastline. And that's 30 miles outside of San Francisco. And oh, you know, all the animals, all the seals getting sick. Oh no, it's chicken pox. All the stuff going into the ocean consistently. And oh, by the way, you know, there's a big fight on about the starfish. Everything, oh, you know, it never happened because the starfish happened in 2008. They've been dumping shit in the ocean long before that. And just because 2008 is the first time they recorded it, how come they didn't record it 10 years before that? And 10 years before that, and 20 years before that. I dove for 14 years. I've never seen anything like it. 300 days a year, 315 rather days a year average in the ocean, on the ocean floor, 6 hours a day. On both oceans. And you can't tell me just because it happened in 2008 that has nothing to do with radiation, because starfish are very vulnerable. But I don't base any of my assumptions, and I don't have assumptions, I don't have conjectures, I have all facts, just like I just told you. But I mean, that one is used all the time to try to bludgeon people. Who cares about the starfish in this context when we have so thousands documented proof? But now we have the EPA at 7,500 becquerels of cesium 137 is a standard in your drinking water. That's not what you hired these people for. That's not what you created these people for. That's not their job to raise the limit. Their job is to deal with that, to come up with solutions. Their job is to raise the alarm. Their job is to rally the nation to solve that issue. Their job is not to bury it and not tell you about it, not have a debate about it, not even try to come up with a solution for it, not even acknowledge it outside of the point of having all the apologists from Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution and all the pro and all the universities, which are all pro-nuclear, otherwise you don't get no money. And so all the deans of all the universities are cowards, are maggots of our society. Right? They all give out funding to go look at nicotine and try to leak it to cancer when there's 4,000 chemicals in your cigarette. They don't even try to build sarcophaguses at university. They just try to find ways to look at the minutest radioactive particles that are indigenous and normal and put that into equation so you can't look at the whole picture of what nuclear industry is all about and how this works and why it's so naughty or why it's so wicked, why it's so alien, why it's so hideous, why it's so monstrous. Why is it on this planet? It's not supposed to be on this planet. It's a creature that doesn't exist on the moon, that doesn't exist on Mars, these man-made radioactive isotopes, and they should never. They're not supposed to. License and agreement is every isotope is locked away. But all the terrorist groups, nuclear power plants, the military industrial complexes, they're all military industrial complexes. You don't need all these isotopes, 3,100 isotopes, to make power. You need 3,100 isotopes defeated directed energy weapons, and you killed everything doing it. And now you're going to raise limits, and then introduce limits that are man-made. And then everybody, no, it never made it here. Well, how do you end up with cesium-137 as a standard in your drinking water when there is zero safe limits of cesium-137 in anything? There is no safe levels. And we got to do the right thing. It's hard to get here every night and do this. But you got all these people coming on board all the time, and they're worried, they're scared, they're terrified, they're misinformed, they're badgered, they're mocked for even considering it, for even looking at it, for even worrying about it, for even raising the issue. What? Fukushima? What? Radiation? What? That's what they get. Because of the gross, disgusting universities, the PR firms, the lobbyists, and the lapdogs in the media themselves, which that's their job. They're PR firms all by themselves. You go to anybody out there that writes for the major organizations, the major papers, the major media, or is in their radio, or is in their TV, and look at their history. They got a list of credentials of PR talents. And their job, no matter how sick and disgusting it is to get on TV, read the teleprompter, and smile and try to sell it to you. That was funny. I was sitting there watching the countdown, waiting for myself to appear, and I was realizing, oh man, I gotta go click on it. Environmental terrorist groups. There's 440 of them we know about worldwide, and they all got nuclear military industrial complexes power plants, and they make fuel for directed energy weapons there, isotopes. I'll come over and say hi to everybody in a few seconds here. I just wanted to make sure everybody understood the very basis of what I'm saying here is that Fukushima's in Japan. It's got 3 melted reactors. And it's St. Paddy's Day every day into the ocean, every minute of every day, and also into the environment. We have WIPP, where we have... Hang on. And so WIPP, let me see, you know, if... Here's what I learned about WIPP from all the PR spokespersons and WIPP staff and everybody else in New Mexico, Carlsbad. You'll get more radiation. Hang on. You would get, let me click this. You get more radiation if you're closer to man-made radiation, contaminated areas, and you get less radiation if you're further away from contaminated areas. That's 7 years of college, dear. You get more radiation if you're on a plane with a smoke detector, with radon 241 into it or something, americium 241. At 50,000 feet, getting a CAT scan and a dental x-ray while drinking a glass of water with 7,500 becquerels of potassium 40 and now 7,400 becquerels of man-made cesium-137 as a drinking water standard. Now that's actually cubic meter of water, whereas 7,500 becquerels of potassium 40 is in your drinking water, which is irrelevant. Cesium's not. In a bathtub full of ocean water and rocks that are releasing natural uranium-238 and natural radon with the plane's curtains up, sun shining in on you, because sunshine is worse radiation than any nuclear fallout ever in the entire history of mankind. Eating a banana, and you get more radiation eating a banana, according to mainstream media, than you would from WIPP or from plutonium or from uranium-238, then you will if you're standing in the middle of any spot where man-made radioactive fallout had occurred. Oh, and you will get less radiation if you're on a space station than if you stood in the middle of Fukushima Daiichi military industrial complexes, nuclear, disguised as a nuclear power plant where they make fuel for directed energy weapons. So isotopes is the fuel for directed energy weapons. I know that's a big mouthful. And you cannot make uranium-238 yellow cake from bananas. And if you do, If you don't get radiation fallout, it's probably from nuclear testing in the 50s and the 60s. Don't worry, all you gotta do is lick an iPhone charger or smile, and the radiation can't hurt you. You gotta keep that smile, though. I mean, you let the smile down, radiation get you good. But if you smile, the radiation cannot hurt you, because it's like pouring a spoonful of water into the ocean and trying to measure the sea level change. Did I get that right? Well, that's a big mouthful, isn't it? But I mean, that's the official story according to all the media and all the PR firms out there, who best go hide out in FEMA camps and in the near future when people find out what the real story is. Let me come back up here. And we got Hanford, where they put 450 billion gallons directly into the soil, just poured it into the soil. Not in drums, but poured it into the soil. Not counting all the drums and everything else. Hanford is 500 miles. It's got 41 miles of open pits where they dump uranium-238 that's contaminated with all the heavy metals, with all the americiums, the neptuniums, the plutoniums. Open pits that are not even lined, not that you can line it, you wouldn't want to line it. You might start a chain reaction if all these metals are mixing together at the bottom of it. And that actually happened at the Tekka River in Russia in the late 40s. Or actually that was the 50s, where they had storage tanks detonated. And they ended up losing another 1,000 square miles. But before that happened, they had lost 9,000 square miles and 7,500 communities. They had closed them down and evacuated them because of the Techa River. And a decade later, they had tanks explode there because it had all the heavy metals into the bottom of it. Just like Fukushima got all those big tanks there. All the heavy metal goes down on the bottom and causes a chain reaction, actually melt down through the tank, just like a nuclear, like coriums disappearing into the earth are doing in Fukushima. Let me keep going. Sellafield, England. There are terrorists. There are some serious environmental terrorists. They got 8 million liters of radioactive contaminated material, water, and isotopes, and atoms, and particles leaching into the UK ocean every friggin' day, folks. Like little Fukushima. Or Fukushima's like Sellafield on steroids. Fukushima's got 3 melted cores. You had Chernobyl. You lost 3,500 square kilometers there. But I mean, it's a lot more contaminated than that. But they got that much you can't go back to. But people are going there. But you hear a lot of people out there saying, oh, the animals all came back. Don't believe that one. Go ahead and look up the studies on what happened to the animals. I haven't got time for it right now. You have Three Mile Island. And by the way, Chernobyl was a 30% meltdown. And it's one-third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima. Then you have Three Mile Island. That was a 50% meltdown. And they had a huge release. They're still denying it. All the apologists are out there still today denying it. But they had a huge, massive release. That's confirmed. You had the SL-1. This is where they in the 50s, they took a reactor and they didn't, and the containment unit. Oh, well, it's not in a populated area, so we don't have to worry about it. So they wanted it to have an accident. And so they can study it, I guess. But they put it, hang on. Oh, I don't want to get that one wrong. SL1, where you to? Peaky boo. Oh. Come on. Come on. Oh, yeah. That was a bad one. They didn't build a containment unit very thick because, hang on. Because it was 60 kilometers, I think it is, outside of a big city in the United States, Idaho. That went over to Yellowstone National Park, all that radioactive fallout. So radioactive fallout, and then, don't even get me started. 40 miles, 64 kilometers of Idaho Falls, Idaho, the SL-1, the stationary low power reactor number one. And this was designed to break down so they can study a nuclear radiation fallout and everything else. That's actually what happened there. They've been trying to bury it ever since and change the numbers and change it from reds to curries and change it over to Beckwells and just totally try to confuse you and misinformation for you. Did I miss anybody? Hanford. And Hanford, that's pouring into Columbia River, and then you got downwinders of people. Anybody that lives around a nuclear power plant anywhere on the planet is being terrorized by environmental terrorists. Right, because you hear all the nuclear pro speakers out there. We gotta get nuclear power. Nuclear power only accounts for 3% of the energy on the planet. Look at the carnage. 9,000 miles evacuated, 7,500 communities. Add on to Chernobyl, 3,500 communities. Body language, hair, clothing, everything is used to indoctrinate you. And then, when someone tries to tell you there's actually something here, you're left with, well, you know, they said it's like a banana. And so, I mean, why would a professor lie to me, Dana? Why would a professor get on TV and lie? They would call him out. No, they won't. They can't. Nobody will ever advertise with him again. That's what they do. Right? The advertiser writes the script. You know, do you get how this all works? How it's always worked? How it'll always work? Unless you take that step. You gotta take a step. I mean, we need millions of voices. You know, if I had a float plane, I had a helicopter, and I had a 300-foot ship, and a whole bunch of other stuff, I'd go out and find the 1,000 square miles of radioactive debris coming over and put cameras out there and stream it. I'd stream, live stream, go out there with the gear, find it and live stream it as you're doing it. Everything. Crowdfund it that way, probably. But everybody could see the Geiger counters in real time. And you had people who knew what they were doing. That would be a good, you know, sound a good fake. Putting nutrition back into our food instead of taking all the potassium. This is what they done. They took potassium, all the nutrients, the magnesium, the iron, the calcium, out of your genetically modified food. And so it's not food anymore because it doesn't have them. And they engineered 5 toxins, one of them a dioxin, into your food. And so that's not food. It looks like food. It's very pretty. It's fascinating how good it looks. But it has zero nutrition in it. This is on purpose. They're not trying to deal with the radiation and updated your countries, your continents, for 3 years. Hardcore from St. Paddy's Day, the never-ending Groundhog St. Paddy's Day. That's what we got here, is a Groundhog's St. Paddy's Day every minute, 1,440 minutes a day. It'll go on till the end of time, until we run out of homeless, got to run away. Then you might get it. Because they're not going to go in there. As long as they can get homeless, they'll stay there. They run out of homeless, and that's coming in Fukushima. They need homeless now for WIPP and homeless for Hanford, homeless for Chernobyl to go in there and do the work. They put 6,000 soldiers in Chernobyl. They all got medals and they got thrown away like garbage. But there were 600,000 of them. It's 1/3 the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima and 3 melted reactors. It's so important. It's so vital. And now we have confirmation of 7,500 becquerels of cesium being introduced through all the venues out there, introducing everybody to it and propagating everybody with all the medias, particularly Woods Hole. They're actually quite evil. That's all they do. Their job is to cover up and stop the blowback and control the blowback from whatever they're doing out there, right? Ah, Woods Hole will go in and investigate it. Popular Mechanics is another one. National Geographic's is another one. Their job is to come out with documentaries and come out with big flashy ships with, right, and then sell it that way. And they're all PR spokespersons. They're all extraordinarily trained. And they're going to tell you that a radioactive isotope is equal to a banana. They're going to tell you that a radioactive isotope, and that's a lie, Because if you eat a banana, you off-gas it. If you eat a radioactive isotope, you're sequestered into your organs, into your bones, into your muscles, into your blood. But they're going to tell you that the radiation from Fukushima is like a banana. Or they're going to tell you the radiation from WIPP is like a dental x-ray. Or they're going to tell you the radiation from Hanford is equal to a walk in the sunshine. Or they're going to tell you that the radiation from Three Mile Island is equal to your drinking water. Which is a outright fabrication. Drink 7,500 becquerels in your drinking water of potassium, that's normal. And you off-gas 7,500 becquerels. Now every time you do it, you got 7,500 becquerels and 7,400 becquerels of cesium-137 lurking around in your shower and your water and your vegetables and the effects of that. Well, you're not going to drink a cubic meter of water, but what about the 225,000 becquerels of strontium that's going to be in that, has to come along with that too, per cubic meter? What about the uranium, all the becquerels till the end of time? What about all the 1,000 stable, long-life, man-made radioactive isotopes? What about the 3,100 isotopes? 260 of them are natural, the rest of them are hideous creatures that are not supposed to be on this planet. There's no purpose on the planet. The only purpose on the planet is to destroy the planet. Like, the implications of everything I'm saying to you, it's just not a joke. It's not a game. This is not a fable. This is not a fiction. This is not something I want to do. This is something I definitely do not want to be doing. I just don't want, you know, anything but this. I'd give it all up in a heartbeat if there was a way out for me, but there's not. You know, we got to carry this message out there that we have an issue and we have an opportunity. We have the technology to at least try. We have 4,800 peer-reviewed academic studies that are published, published every day. And these institutions, these professors, these students, these man hours, these locations are all ready to go again. And they can come up with filters. 4,800 universities in the world went to work doing a contest to come up with the best filter. And they all shared their information. And then the day after, 4,800 universities and students and academics and institutions start putting nutrition into food. I'd feel a lot better. But right now we have these environmental terrorist groups that are not going to give it up. This is too easy money for them. And they don't care because it's going to happen to their own children. They go out and they get all this money and they buy swimming pools, and their swimming pools, every cubic meter is going to be 7,500 becquerels of this, hot man-made radioactive isotopes, 225,000 becquerels of strontium man-made radioactive isotopes, hundreds of thousands of the other radioactive man-made isotopes their children will be swimming in every day. They can't escape that in their showers or in their bathtubs. It's in their best interest to come on board. It's in everybody's best interest, except for a handful of the elites who somehow think they're going to come out on top of this. But they lose everything. We lose everything, the entire biosphere, the entire oceans. We can't stop the hemorrhaging because we don't try. We send in the homeless to do the most dangerous job on the planet who can't even read or can't even write. And somehow or another, I'm the bad guy for talking about this. For criticizing Woods Hole and everything else out there, for using bananas and walking in sunshine and insignificant potassium 40 into these equations. And all that does is confuse people, and it's hard for people to digest it, what's going on. It's hard to pick through the lies when that's what they do. That's all they do, is they keep injecting potassium 40 and high insignificant normal everyday background radiation, high counts of that, and then comparing it to low counts of man-made radioactive material when none of it is true. It's meant to confuse you. And what all I'm trying to do to you is make you understand that a banana, if you eat that kind of radiation, it doesn't belong in a conversation, but I have to come up here every single night and drive it home. I have to do that constantly. It doesn't lose its energy. And so when you're releasing these million watts at a time, you're increasing a million watts with this own creature. That's how I see it, explained in layman's term, into the environment. When you're talking about hundreds of thousands of tons, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of tons of this stuff aerosoled and atomized and released into the environment, that's global warming. That's global warming on an unimaginable scale. These are hot particles. These are pumping out energy at the, you know, the gammas, the betas, and the alphas are traveling at almost the speed of light. Not quite, but close to it. How do you get those speeds and not have a side effect in your environment? There's a good article, study, Small Nuclear War. Seems up in Drudge today. I happened to be on it for a minute. I was like, oh, radiation. Let me go check it out. Small nuclear war would destroy the world. I'm just gonna get a little bit loud. With an estimated 17,000 weapons in the world, we have the power to exterminate the humanity many times over. But it would take a full scale. It wouldn't take a full scale nuclear war to make Earth uninhabitable. We were shooting 2.5 million rounds of dirty bombs in Iraq every friggin' month. 5 million rounds a month. Imagine you shot 5 million rounds in New York City every month, month after month. You get any civilians? Would there be any windows left? Especially if you had the crazy retarded Americans. No offense to anybody who's retarded or got someone who is. And that's a name that I don't want to, you know, lose because it's a powerful slur. And it's not meant to offend anybody, only the people I'm directing it to. As an insult, I'm sure I could come up with a better one. Even a small regional nuclear war on the other side of the planet would disrupt global climate for at least a decade and wipe out the ozone layer for a decade. What's going to happen when you're releasing all these radioactive atomized? See, a nuclear war radioactive material is totally different than what we talk about at Fukushima and Sellafield and Hanford. But like Fukushima in particular, where it's running over the hot coriums, the water, and getting up into the ocean, being liberated into the environment, but it's also aerosol on the coriums and released into the environment. That's steam. And by the way, every nuclear power plant, it's got fuel pools. They're going through 100,000 liters a day of radioactive water, and it's evaporated into your environment. And that's why leukemia is so high around nuclear power plants and in communities with nuclear power plants downwind or downriver, rather. And downwind, you know, where the prevailing winds are, if you live in that regional district area. They said today that autism just jumped by 30%. They never changed the way they look for it. They never changed the way they test for it. They never changed the way they seek out the... They said it rose by 30%. In Japan, in Fukushima Prefecture, 6 out of 10 children tested were diabetic, which is another direct issue that's connected apparently directly to radiation. Sister Jackie Hudson, and years ago, she spent a lot of time, she was a nun, she had spent a lot of time at the hospital, I can't remember which one it was, and she was a nun, and so there was a children's hospital, and she got to know the pediatrician, obviously, because she lost so many children to cancer, treating them for cancer. And that pediatrician had done a lot of soul searching and a lot of searching and had discovered that all the children that come in there and that she treat, she couldn't save them no matter how good she was. Even though she taught in university, that's what she was going to accomplish. And she got her dream job and she couldn't save the children. And one day she had come to the realization that the reason for these types of cancers that children were dying of was directly related, all of them, to the nuclear industry, to living in the community downriver or close to the reactors. All the children had that in common. And this was a revolutionary thing for Sister Jackie Hudson. And she dedicated the rest of her life to going against the nuclear industry. And she was also arrested. She was put in jail, and she was made to clean the Humvees that came back from Iraq, and they were contaminated with uranium-238. And so there was a bunch of them, and they used to get really sick, break out in sores. You hear Dr. Doug Rourke, the head of the Pentagon in Kuwait in 91 on the Highway of Death, where, think about the A-10 Warthog. It shoots a ton and a half of uranium-238 that's contaminated with the plutonium and all the other radioactive isotopes because it's left over from the chain reaction. It's supposed to be in a sarcophagus, not in a plane with a as a bullet. It's never. It was. Ne it's that's not what the licensing agreements are. All the nuclear power plants producing 3% of the electricity on the entire friggin' planet. Nothing. And look at the carnage they have done. Look at the absolute carnage they've created on this planet. That's not going to go away. You're not going to get those 9,000 square miles in Russia back, or the 3,500 square kilometers, or the 30,000 square miles kilometers in Japan. You're not going to be able to decontaminate that. You can't decontaminate. If my hand was radioactive and I poured battery acid over it, I would liberate the radioactive isotopes and particles and atoms and blah 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 and have no hand. But you can't kill it. You can put my hand in an incinerator and burn it at 5,000 degrees. You're just going to liberate the isotopes, the atoms, the particles. Do you get any idea how hideous this shit is and why we need 4,800 peer review? Look, if you looked up and you seen a comet coming at you, you'd have 4,800 peer review academic studies tomorrow morning with the funding and good to go. All the parents packing the kids' lunch. Come on, Johnny. Come on, Sally. Don't forget. Don't be late. You gotta get to university and save the world, honey. But we can turn the other cheek and pretend it's not gonna happen. That there is no meteorite coming at us named Fukushima. That we didn't increase the water standards now to include man-made radioactive isotopes of just cesium-137, which is hideous, unimaginably hideous. But we're not including 30 times more strontium-90 like we should be, which goes directly into your bones. We're not including the uranium and the plutoniums and all their daughters, 238 to 239 to 240, 241. But the many other aberrations that go with these decays and these radioactive changes of these particles and atoms. And so researchers developed a computer model of the Earth's atmosphere and ran simulations to find out what would happen if there was a nuclear war with just a fraction of the world's arsenal. What they saw was the stuff of nightmares. Of nightmares. This was a study. And we have more than that amount of radiation released into our environment from 9 years of firing dirty bombs in Iraq every month, 2.5 million, and Fukushima and Sellafield and Hanford and, you know, just in that time allotment. And so should I be here each night doing what I'm doing, even though it wears me the freak right to, just frazzles me. But it drives me because I know I can't escape this, and neither can you, and that people out there are looking for the truth, and that if we don't have something for these people so they can learn, so they can have some closure, so they can try to readjust, so they can get out of the friggin' way, so they can actually make an informed decision, then we're in a lot of trouble. Because I couldn't get that. And it took me 4 months to put that instantly. Because after 5 decades, they ain't gonna give it up. And so the only thing that could stop this is 4,800 universities coming on board and doing the right thing, or everybody starting to rise and speak out and lash out and stand up and correct the misnomers. Because if you go approach any of the experts, they're going to try to hit you with a banana. That's not going to work on you. You say, well, I can eat a banana, I'm going to off-gas it. If I eat the cesium, then I'm going to keep that in me forever. I just, and it's cumulative. Every time I eat something, I got more into me. It doesn't go away. If I inhale it, it's many times worse. But because these radioactive particles are so small, so tiny, so durable, such a long, and to see like a half-life in radioactive terminology is actually times 10. See how they lie to you and how they manipulate you? Oh, it's only got an 8-day half-life. It's 80 days. But it didn't come by itself. Radioactive isotopes don't just travel. All the gases don't just split up, and all the radioactive atoms and particles don't just go their own way. Right? No, of course not. The Trans-Pacific pollution studies I've shown and talked about recently, how smoke and forest fires can easily get up into the jet stream, but will also easily cross the oceans and will congregate and accumulate on the continent and turn into smog right from across the ocean in a matter of a week. Pollution from automobiles and smog got moved into the city, across the ocean, contributed to your pollution or air pollution or dirt pollution. And we know California had over 1,500 radioactive atoms, hot particles with the isotope in them, per cubic meter of air, lingering in California. Shocking. It's so shocking. And it was the same thing all the way along the coastline, hot particles lingered. Studies below of Health Canada going out and flying through plumes for 18 hours, lingering from one end of British Columbia to the other end. Really high particles. They were only looking for a couple of certain isotopes. For 18 hours, they flew through the plumes. March 20th, 2011. And so you'll keep hearing people say you can't make it across the ocean, but there's the jet streams. They're here in 3 days, 4 days. By the end of a week, it's everywhere in North America. Nothing left. Nothing can escape it. But under the jet stream is the most biggest loads. And if you don't know any better and you're eating GMO, you're in a lot of trouble. Because that fuels cancer all on its own. And so what's the glyphosates and the formaldehydes going to do to you? The toxins and the dioxins that they got engineered into it going to do to you? When you got no nutrition to battle it. Even if it was full of nutrition, just with the glyphosates and the formaldehydes and the three other toxic pesticides they have built into the DNA of the food, which is not food, it's a creature, it's a GMO creature. It doesn't qualify as food. There's tiny particles of everything left, but they're insignificant. You can't engineer it all out or the plant won't exist, and it can't pass a certain standard, I guess. But it's inconceivable if you look at the studies of what they've done to GMO foods and how 100% of your corner shops, 80% of your grocery shops, and the rest of it is contaminated with pesticides anyway. You can't trust a single word that comes out of your mouth. They've been caught so many times when natural and organic turns out to be GMO and GMO. And we have this capacity. We have this amazing ability as a human race that we could dig ourselves out of this one. But I mean, it's good. Just if you put cancer-fighting agents, the actual ones, not the pharmaceutical ones, because all your pet food and all your baby food, all your supplements, GMO, all your pharmaceuticals, GMO, then the bovines and the growth hormones and the vaccines they use in your cows or in your meats and stuff like that. You're better off eating turkeys, because turkeys are free range and you get a lot more meat for your money, and it's much, much healthier meat than chicken. I can't eat chicken. I won't touch it. Turkey's good. They free range it. They're not chopping the beaks off. They're not, you know, the animals are running around and they're harvested a couple of points a year. So compared to a chicken, it's a much more ethical meat. It doesn't have the adrenaline in it from stress and everything else. Everybody's like, fuck off, dude, now leave me alone. I like chicken. But I realize I gotta have one of those chats where these are environmental terrorist groups. Yeah? I should come down and say hi to everybody. These are environmental terrorist groups. Fukushima, WIPP, Hanford, 3 Mile Island. By no means are this all of them. There's 440 that we know about. There's SL1, Chernobyl, Techa River in Russia, which lost 9,000 square miles and 7,500 communities. Sellafield, England, 8 million liters a day. That's where they used to make the MOX fuel. There's Pakistan, freaky fuckers, excuse the language. India, there's crazy Israel down there, shooting 25,000 depleted uranium, 155 millimeter from the, right, you know. Like, think about the A-10 Warthog. Let me go back to Israel for a second. 25,000, 155 millimeter depleted uranium rounds into Palestine, into the communities, into the neighborhoods, indiscriminate, with a 900-foot kill ratio. That's friggin' crazy stuff. Because all that blows right back into their own country. It's just like they just don't care. You got Russia doing it, China's doing it. There's a whole bunch of countries out there. I mean, what England done is just over the top friggin' evil, dumping it, barrels after barrels, non-stop, off UK, and then now they got Sellafield hemorrhaging 8 million liters a day. This is over the top. This is unacceptable. And people don't know. And people don't understand because they're inundated with bananas, walking in sunshine, 7,500 becquerels of potassium, 40 in your water, blah, 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 from all the apologists, from all the creepy, creepy, disgusting people that we actually thought, you know, was there to flush out and were experts. There are experts in deception and misrepresentation and misdirection. And that's why I exist, because I just can't take that anymore, and I know better. And so what I know, I know. And so what I know, I discuss. It's like a gram of uranium is enough to power 3,000 watt heaters. Imagine being in a room, really good insulation, no windows, no doors, and 333 heaters. And that gram of uranium is going to run them under nuclear, the way they do it with nuclear, the fuel lasts 12 months, 24 months, and then they pull it out. But that uranium still has energy, it's just no good for that nuclear E equals MC squared formula. They need a certain enrichments, blah, 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 for their isotopes, so it's no good. I mean, you can still use that to make the old-fashioned power plants work, what's left over. You can just keep reusing this stuff. But a gram of it is a million watts. And that's like turning 3,000 watt heater on in a little room, but 333 of them. That's energy. It doesn't matter if you aerosol it and atomize it like happened at Fukushima at all. You still have that energy, it's still free radicals, it's still pumping it out. If you get it in your body, in a million years' time, it'll give you the same kind of cancer as it would on the first day.